Thank you, Jane. Hello and welcome to Look North, our top story tonight. The mother of a woman from Huddersfield who was killed by her ex-boyfriend is campaigning to change the way the police deal with domestic abuse.
It's the same sort of pattern, it's the same story that's emerging, that had our daughters, our sisters, our friend been believed, then it would have been a completely different outcome and we wouldn't have lost our loved ones.
We'll speak to a women's aid charity about what more can be done. Also tonight, a coroner finds there were missed opportunities to help a soldier who took his own life at an army base in North Yorkshire. Her last year as a professional cyclist, Lizzie Deignan announces her plans for retirement and what the future holds. It is, of course, Children in Need Day. We'll talk to fundraisers and see how some of your donations are being spent.
And it's going to get gradually cooler through the weekend before a cold week and a taste of winter next week. I'll be back at the end of the programme with all the details.
Hello and thank you for joining us this Friday evening. The mother of a woman from West Yorkshire who was killed by her abusive ex-boyfriend is spearheading a campaign to change the way the police deal with domestic abuse. Bethany Fields was stabbed to death in Huddersfield in 2019. She told West Yorkshire Police she was frightened and had asked multiple agencies for help in the weeks before her death. Her mother, Pauline Jones, says her daughter's fears were not taken seriously and far too many women are meeting the same fate as her daughter. Nine women were killed in a five-year period, despite raising concerns with West Yorkshire Police. So she wants victims to be believed and their fears acted on quickly. This week, she took her campaign to Parliament. Cathy Killick reports.
No mother should lose her daughter, but Pauline Jones mourns hers every day. Bethany Ray Fields was a 21-year-old university student when she was killed by her ex-boyfriend, despite warning the police about him.
Be at peace now, baby. You're an angel, and I love you with all my heart and soul.
Now Pauline is campaigning for change.
BRF is using my daughter Bethany Rayfield's initials in the hope of saving other victims of domestic abuse and any kind of violence or stalking or any kind of threat, and that the authorities that these people go to will believe them and react and fast. That's what my aim is, to get this out.
Pauline's been working with her MP, Katie White, to promote the Believe, React, Fast message. She hopes it leads to a culture change that will save lives.
We've got hundreds of homicides each year happening, you know, and we need to do something about it. And the onus is on the victim to prove that actually they're, you know, they're in danger. Well, that's not working, clearly, and it didn't work for Bethany, sadly. And we need to do something to shift that.
In Parliament this week, Ms White asked for backing for the BRF campaign and had this response from the Prime Minister.
We do need a culture shift here, and we have committed to halving violence against women and girls in a decade. No government has ever made that commitment before. I hope that can be something which is shared across the House, because this is so important, and it starts with that central question of belief and confidence.
It was positive and encouraging, and I'm hoping that he's going to implement it sooner rather than later. And I do believe that BRF will help with his pledge of having domestic violence in 10 years.
Bethany's killer, Paul Crowther, had a history of domestic abuse and was known to be mentally unstable. West Yorkshire Police have apologised for their failings in her case and say they've changed their approach to women's safety, with domestic abuse cases now reviewed daily. But they also acknowledge it's too late for Bethany. Cathy Killick, BBC Look North, Leeds.
Well, earlier I spoke to Holly Venn from Sheffield Women's Aid, and I began by asking if all domestic violence calls that come into the police should be taken seriously and assume the person is in danger.
Simply, yes. You know, women and all victims who are calling about domestic abuse are reaching out because actually they are frightened and they are in danger. We know that it takes absolute courage for women to be able to reach out and make contact with the police, and at the very least, they deserve to be appropriately responded to. And specialist organisations like ourselves, you know, absolutely recognise that, you know, victims should be trusted, victims should be believed.
Clearly the system needs to change. What do you think needs to happen?
I think that there is a whole piece of work to do around specialist organisations such as ourselves working in partnership with the police, and we work really positively with South Yorkshire Police, for example, at Sheffield Women's Aid. We know that there is a culture of distrust actually when survivors are reaching out to speak to the police. They are concerned that they won't respond appropriately, which this case actually demonstrates. But there is secondary also a concern around the culture and lack of trust in policing, which, you know, national reports like the Casey report highlighted, you know, rampant misogyny, rampant sexism, which actually doesn't give people confidence that victims will be treated appropriately.
And Holly, what should someone do if they're watching this tonight and they're worried for their safety?
We would always recommend in the first instance that people call 999 if they are in immediate danger. You know, that's something we would always recommend for survivors to do. However, if it's not an emergency, then what we would absolutely recommend is there is the National Domestic Abuse Helpline, which is run by Refuge. There are local helplines in Yorkshire that survivors are able to reach out to. You know, they are staffed by specialist organisations who have experience in working with survivors and understand and just how difficult it is for them to reach out and access support. So they'll be trained, experienced staff who are able to take those calls.
Holly, thank you for your time this evening.
Thank you for having me.
Next tonight, a coroner has said the army missed opportunities to support a soldier who took his own life at a military base in North Yorkshire. However, it did not directly contribute to his death. An inquest into the death of Nicholas Hart, who was found dead at Catterick Garrison, recorded a conclusion of suicide. Phil Bodmer was at the hearing.
Highlander Nicholas Hart was described as a popular and likeable soldier. The 33-year-old was serving with the 4th Battalion of the Royal Regiment of Scotland at Catterick Garrison in North Yorkshire when he was found dead in February 2022. Today, the coroner, at an inquest into his death, recorded a conclusion of suicide.
In summing up, Assistant Coroner Jonathan Leach told the hearing, although there were missed opportunities, Army colleagues were not aware of Nicholas Hart's previous attempts to take his own life in 2012 and 2014. Mr. Leach said he was satisfied Mr. Hart's increased drinking and marital problems at the time of his death were a bigger contributing factor to him taking his own life.
Family members, including his wife Sarah and sister Jamie, have been attending the hearing in North Allerton over the last 10 days.
It has been an incredibly difficult time for Sarah and Jamie. Hearing the evidence over the last 2 weeks about how Nicky came about his death has been exhausting and painful for them both. Nicky had a significant history of mental health problems, including several suicide attempts. This was recognised too late. When Nicky made the decision to reach out for help, he did not receive it. Sarah and Jamie are understandably exhausted and very upset from hearing the evidence over the last 2 weeks and have gone home now to spend time with their children. Thank you.
The family left the hearing without making comment, but in a statement, they said they remain of the opinion had Nicky received earlier treatment and help, his death could have been prevented. Phil Bodmer, BBC Look North.
And our thoughts are with Nicky's family. Now you're watching Friday's Look North. Still to come on tonight's programme, we meet the superheroes doing something spectacular for children in need. Some more news from around the region now, and a baby girl who was born after her mother fell to her death from a tower block in Leeds has been discharged from hospital. Emma Atkinson plunged from a 9th-floor flat at Shakespeare Towers in Bermentofts last month. The baby had been in a critical condition after being delivered by C-section, but a court heard today that she's making miraculous progress. A mental health hospital in Doncaster has been removed from special measures but is still rated inadequate. The Care Quality Commission says some areas of Cheswold Park Hospital have improved, but it's retained its overall inadequate rating. The hospital has now been brought back under NHS control. An investigation is underway after a fire destroyed a derelict house on one of the most expensive streets in Leeds. West Yorkshire Fire Service were called to Sandmore Drive in Alwardley at around 7 o'clock last night after reports of the roof being on fire. Six fire engines attended the scene and a cause is still to be determined. North Yorkshire Council has been defending its decision to stop free home-to-school transport for thousands of pupils. The free service is still available for those who attend their nearest school, but had been stopped for those who choose schools further afield. This week, a petition signed by 3,000 parents was handed to the council, with families raising their concerns. But the council says they're falling in line with government guidelines and claims savings of up to £4 million a year will be made.
We are changing something and we are doing less of what we did before. We understand that's difficult for parents and understand that that's doing something different. However, when I look at that across a broad range of where we need to make savings, every child who is eligible for transport to a nearest school will still get that.
Now, a shop in North Yorkshire has helped their local community save almost £1 million over the last year. Eastfield Community Shop opened last year as a social supermarket, offering highly discounted products to local people, as well as a community kitchen where children can eat for free. In the last 12 months, the shop has supported thousands of people, helping members save nearly £100,000 on their shopping. Fantastic. Now, a derelict house in North Yorkshire is set to be renovated to provide one local family with an affordable home to rent. The Knaresborough Community Land Trust say they hope to be the first of multiple properties in the town. They're now looking for tradespeople and donations to make the DIY SOS-style project a reality. Beth Parsons has been to find out more about it and see what people think about rental prices in the area.
House prices, a frightening prospect for first-time buyers.
They're very high, but they are always have always been in this area.
One of my daughters actually lives in Hampswick because she couldn't afford to live around here. So
would they like to live here?
Oh, definitely, yeah.
Rental prices, I've been looking in windows today. You pay more on rental than what you would for mortgage payments.
Most of the people whom I work with, they rather to live in Leeds or Bradford because of the expensive houses.
I mean, I have two sons that really could do with buying property, but it may not be in this area.
It's no secret that house prices are high. It's a national problem. For some areas, it often means people have to leave their hometowns to afford to live. A particularly bitter pill to swallow when, despite demand outstripping supply, some homes sit empty.
According to the group Action on Empty Homes, in Yorkshire and the Humber, one in every 50 homes empty and unlived in. For North Yorkshire in particular, that's even worse. It's one in every 26. But for one house here in Knaresborough, there's a plan.
No one's lived here for 12 years, but it's now been bought by the Knaresborough Community Land Trust.
So here we have the kitchen. We have a bathroom off the kitchen currently, which is not going to stay. We're going to put a modern bathroom upstairs.
The aim is to renovate this home and then let it out to a family at an affordable rent, a few hundred pounds cheaper than the rentals currently available in Knaresborough. The Sponsor a Brick campaign has been launched to help raise the £70,000 needed for repairs.
The house is about 90 years old and you never really know what you're going to find until you start digging under the skin. We know that there are huge problems with the roof. As for all the other things, it all depends at the end of the day on the sort of support we get from the community. If we can get people from the local community to give us volunteer hours, if we can get local tradespeople to come and work with us for friendly rates. We're hoping that we can partner with the local building colleges and get some of their apprentices to come here and do work with us. This is a really fantastic opportunity for Knaresborough to come forward and say, we want to help people to live in our wonderful town.
When the house is finished, a family will be chosen to live here.
What we will be doing is looking at a family that has a very strong local connection to Knaresborough, whether that means that they are currently living in Knaresborough or whether they are working in Knaresborough. I think the board that decides who gets the house will have a very tough decision to make.
Assuming all goes well, the Knaresborough Community Land Trust call this home their starter house. They hope to do the same for other homes, for more families in the future. Beth Parsons, BBC Lent North, Knaresborough.
And we'll be watching their progress. Now onto sport, and Yorkshire has produced a long list of champion cyclists over the years, but few have achieved what this one, 35-year-old Lizzie Dieden, has. Today, Dieden has announced that next year will be her final one as a professional rider. Well, living back in Yorkshire with her husband and two daughters, Dieden has spoken to our reporter Mark Ansell to explain why she's taken the decision to climb off a bike at the end of 2025.
You know, next year I'll be 36, and you know, we moved home to Yorkshire a year ago. My daughter started school here, and I just feel like the next chapter of my life is waiting.
Do you have plans in place for what you're going to do after your career as a professional cyclist for, I think we calculated, 18 years?
Yeah, 18 years. It's been a lifetime, really. So, no firm plans. I don't know exactly what I want to do, just that I want to stay involved in the sport. I think, you know, I've gained so much experience and expertise that it'd be a shame to waste it. I do coach already, and I enjoy that. I find it very fulfilling. But I'm pretty open-minded about what the next chapter looks like.
What is your career highlight? Would it be the 2015 World Championships win?
It's hard to say, really. There's been a few, but probably the world title, yeah. I think in cycling we're very lucky that we get this huge honour of wearing the rainbow jersey. It's something really special. I'd tried so hard to win that title for so many years that it was just almost a shame to say it. It was a relief as well. Like, oh my goodness, phew, I've done it. To win a world title, to get everything together, all your luck, your best legs on the best day, on the hardest day, was a really, really big achievement.
What was it like winning silver at the London 2012 Olympics?
Very, very special, overwhelming, completely unexpected. You know, I was hoping to come top 10 there and came away with the first GB medal, and kind of the effect, the ricochet effect after that in, you know, my local community, and the way the British fans got excited by sport was so infectious. Like, it was such a special time to be involved in sport in this country, and I was the one who kicked it off. So it was really, yeah, an overwhelming experience.
You've had two children mid-career and shown that you're more than capable of coming back, perhaps even stronger afterwards. Do you think that sets an example to others?
Yeah, I really believe that, you know, physically, mentally, I'm stronger than I ever was before having children. And a woman's career doesn't have to end when they become a mother. You know, I think that's probably, if I think of all the things that mean the most to me, it would be that.
And she's still only 36. That's amazing, isn't it? And there's much more on Lizzie Dieden's decision to retire next year, available on the BBC Sport website cycling section. And staying with sport, in rugby league, the women's Super League champions York Valerie are tonight celebrating their win this evening with an open top bus tour around the city. The team were cheered on by fans as they took on the bus tour around York. They made history last month by becoming the first team to retain the women's Super League title. And now, like they say, it's time for something completely different. Yes, of course, Pudsey is here with me. It is the big day. The annual BBC Children in Need appeal has arrived. And each year, your generosity brings real change to young people's lives right here. All week, we've been sharing stories of how your donations really do make a difference. And in Leeds, the Hunslet Rugby Foundation receives a grant to power an all-action rugby club for young people, getting them together to socialise and be part of a team.
Hi, I'm Neve. I'm 11 years old. I play rugby at Leeds Corinthians. When I'm on the pitch, I feel, like, powerful. And it's an energising sport. I think it's important for children to play rugby for their mental health. Sports is like my whole life, so I'd feel sad without it.
Good girl, call for it. Yep, brilliant, well done.
Hi, I'm Michael Nuttall. I am the foundation manager at the Hunslet Rugby Foundation. We have teamed up with the Leeds Corinthians, which is where we are at right now. We started this project around 12 months ago.
Well done, Amelia, fantastic, yes.
Fast forward 12 months, as you can see, there's 30, 40 kids out here enjoying rugby, and that's what they've come together to do.
That's brilliant. Well done!
Everyone gets here, the girls, the boys, and they're really enjoying it every single week with smiles on their faces, which is what it's all about. Sport helps children in their life for many reasons, but in particular for these kids, it's more the social side of things. It's bringing them together and being part of a team. The Children in Need money makes a massive difference, and it's been able to provide these opportunities for these young children, and not just the young children as well, the families. So we've got parents that have took on voluntary roles here, so they've become coaches of the team.
Hi, I'm Amelia, I'm 11 years old. I play fly half at the Leeds Corinthians and I love it.
Ready, Amelia? Yep.
Rugby is basically life to me. I watch it all the time when it's on, and since I started playing rugby, I've just loved it. Sport's important for children to get the spirits feeling high and for the mental health and to make them feel happy about life.
We're massively grateful to Children in Need for the funding. It's impacted young children, it's impacted their families. We've got another 2 years left of this, so hopefully we can continue to grow that. Hopefully we continue to make a huge difference, and that's what it's all about.
Thank you, Children in Need!
Oh, it's so good to see what a difference it makes. We can't thank you enough. We can't salute you enough either. Well, each year you rise to the challenge of finding different ways to fundraise. Back on the road this year, ready to get some miles in and zip around our part of the world, Cathy Minton and her cameraman Mark Graham have been cheering you on.
It's Children in Need, and we're here in Doncaster. Now, they say that you should never meet your heroes, but here at Hill House School, that's not the case, is it?
Yeah.
Fundraisers, assemble! It was a marvellous morning at Hill House School's Superhero Breakfast Club. Hiya! You've got Ant-Man, Superman, Batman, but what about Golf Man?
Well, here at Rother Valley Golf Centre, Jason Ripley is putting for Pudsey.
I am doing a 12-hour putt-a-thon on a putting mat that is 13 foot long.
Are you bored? Do you wish you'd been doing it at the crazy golf course?
Well, it's crazy anyway.
If you say so, Jason. Either way, he's raised over £500. Now, I'll have a sausage roll and some live music, please. Leeds band About Faces performed a very intimate gig in a high street pasty emporium. Pudsey even joined in on guitar. Crumbs! And proving Children in Need is fun for all ages, Deangate Care Home in Barnsley led an online chair aerobics session, with lots of other care homes in the region joining in online. And it's ping pong all day long at Curry's in Sheffield.
5, 6, 5, 6, 7, 8. You can tell how long they've been fundraising for Children in Need here at Huddersfield Fire Station. Look at this vintage Pudsey bear. Don't worry, Pudsey, we've all changed over the years. Now, Ash, you've been out since 6 a.m. How's it going?
It's going very well. We've raised around £2,000 so far.
And you've been doing this for a long time, haven't you? What's the running total since the millennium?
So £126,000 so far.
Fantastic work. Keep those buckets rattling. This is the 2P Challenge at Pudsey Leisure Centre near Leeds. It's been going on for 6 years. Donations are coming in and the 2Ps are being counted. And by the end of the day, this Pudsey will be covered.
People start saving from tomorrow, so after the event they start saving for next year. It's become a thing.
This is the last stop of the day. We're at Knavesmire Primary School in York, and these children want one thing. They want to see a teacher getting gunged!
Oh, the glamour. Thank you so much for everything you do. It really does make a difference. Pudsey will, of course, be along very shortly. But in the meantime, here's how to donate to BBC Children in Need Appeal. Follow the website link or scan the QR code on your screen now. There it is. Now, on to the weather prospects. Keely, we're all ears.
Oh, very good. How long have you been working on that one?
Oh, all day.
It's very good indeed. Let me show you a picture, Amanda. This was last night's moon, and tonight it's going to be a full moon. Not only a full moon, but it's going to be a supermoon. The last supermoon of the year. It's the fourth of the year, and it is going to be a beaver moon. It's the beaver moon. We're not going to see another supermoon until October next year. A little bit frustrating because we haven't quite a lot of cloud out there, but you won't need very many breaks, so it won't be a very big a break in the cloud to actually see the moon. So keep your pictures coming in. Do send any pictures that you see overnight tonight to the Weather Watchers page. You can send it to me on Instagram, keely.donovan. So the theme of the weather over the next few days is for it to cool down. So cooling down over the weekend and then getting cold into next week. The air coming down from the Arctic. And it's this area of low pressure we're keeping our eye on. We've got a yellow warning from the Met Office, the risk of rain, sleet and snow on that. And that will move out to the east and leave us all in cold Arctic air for next week. So overnight frost, the risk of icy stretches and some wintry showers, and really feeling like winter. This afternoon, there's been quite a bit of cloud out there, and we go into the evening with quite a bit of cloud. As I mentioned, there will be some breaks in that cloud if you want to catch a glimpse of the moon, but overall, it will be fairly cloudy, the odd shower into the hills. And then later in the night, we'll start to see thicker cloud. And this is actually a cold front. We'll start to see a little bit of patchy rain just starting to tuck in later in the night. Temperatures dropping back to around 6 or 7 degrees. So let's have a look at those high water times. In Scarborough at 3:41, in Whitby at 3:27. So we may well some places start off actually on a bright note, but quite quickly that cloud and very patchy light rain drizzle will sink southwards, and then brighter skies will spread from the north, spreading down into parts of South Yorkshire as well. There could be the odd afternoon shower, very isolated, most likely in the west, but for most of us it does look like a fine afternoon with some spells of sunshine and a moderate west to southwest breeze. And then I think Sunday looks like a fine day. It'll be bright with spells of sunshine. There could be a little bit hazy at times, and later in the day there could be the odd wintry shower just tucking in across parts of the Pennines and the Peak District, but generally Sunday does look dry, and then it's really cold into next week. We are looking at the risk of rain, sleet and snow overnight Monday into Tuesday, and then for the rest of the week it looks cold with the risk of frost and ice by night, some wintry showers but also some sunshine by day. But it does look like winter.
Oh, wonderful. Now, look what I found underneath Pudsey's
bottom. Oh, a little gift for me.
A little gift. I'm going to throw them to you.
Oh, no. Oh, that went well, didn't it? Excellent.
I knew that would happen. Get them on.
There we go.
Perfect. Come and join
oh,
us.
Oh, no, don't sit down anymore.
We'll be here later on for the 10:25. Join us then. Goodbye.